champion to the online broadcast network, AfterBuzz TV. Over 20 million weekly downloads in over 150 countries and your number one source for after-show entertainment. TV, the destination for TV superfans, producing aftershows for over 300 of your favorite TV shows, interviewing celebrities and showrunners, and bringing you behind-the-scenes exclusives. All thanks to E! Entertainment's Maria Menounos, producer Kevin Undergaro, and internet leader Akamai. Now, let the buzz begin!
Hey everyone, welcome back to the Banshee After Show here on AfterBuzz TV. Talking about Season 3, Episode 10, We All Pay Eventually. It's a season finale. I'm Matt Lieberman. Joining me as always, Modest Rose is here.
What's going on?
Miss Oriana Leo is here.
Hey, Fancy Babes.
And Mr. Isaac Johnson is here.
Hello as well, Fancy Babes.
Yes. We have a very special guest today, Mr. Matt Servitto, who plays Brock Lotus, will be joining us over the phone in just under 10 minutes. Mm-hmm. And before we get into that, first of all, first impressions of this finale?
Amazing.
Great.
Yes. But they introduced so many characters.
They introduced so much plot. Yeah.
I was so upset when it ended. It made me sadder.
Yeah. I love a finale that really gives us a sense of what we'll be contending with in the future.
Sure.
And is all about world building and season building. Because, you know, we had a lot of... We've had climax, I feel like, all season long. Like, we had climax when Trieste was killed, when Siobhan was killed. We had climax when Chaitin was killed. Mm-hmm. We had climax when everyone was being taken. So of course we got an epic battle sequence and fight between Stowe and Anna. Mm-hmm. But really the back half is all about building season 4.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you would almost think they'd have like nothing left in the bag at this point, especially action wise. Like, mm-hmm. we've had so much action, but like this really delivered for a finale.
I think the Banshee bag is bottomless.
Yeah,
perhaps. I hope so.
Yeah, there's no bottom to that bag.
Yeah, but I will have to say that what, you know, Matt and, you know, Tom were eating at Miles Diner, the burger, you know, they had to walk out on that. There is much better food being served at Miles Diner, especially the pie, just will say. So next season...
Are you plugging your own review of a fake restaurant right now?
I'm just saying, you know, Miles Diner did play a big part as well in the season finale. Just want to make sure of that.
And you should all go check out the Restaurant Fiction podcast, perhaps?
Later for plugs. Let's get on with it.
All right. So I want to first, before Matt jumps on the line, I want to talk about these flashbacks where we learn a very key element of Hood's past. We get to see the moment when he was made from man into Superman, the moment he was broken by some sort of hidden secret, super double, triple double secret probation branch of the government. His captor played by David Harbour, who just always plays such wonderful dicks. Like, he
I love wonderful dicks.
Wonderful dicks.
Oh, yeah.
Shining, shimmering,
that's what
splendid
she said.
Dicks.
That's what she said.
Huge fan myself.
Yeah. But
I'm gonna judge anyone who is.
We finally get a sense of what he was inducted into, that he was an army rat. He's got issues with his dad.
Well, big issues.
For Wade, we had a huge like therapy session.
No longer issues because he killed him.
He killed his dad.
Wow.
But now that he's admitted it, that's obviously the breaking point, kind of. He's owned by Dalton.
Here's the thing, though. Did he kill his dad, or...
Did the dad just make him say it?
Yeah.
I think he actually did it.
I think he didn't break him in that way?
I mean, I think he was going for breaking him, for sure.
Get the deepest, darkest dirt possible. It's Psychops 101, guys.
Yeah, I know. We learned that earlier in the season.
Yeah.
No, I think he absolutely did.
He probably was protecting himself and protecting his mom, you know?
Yeah, well, and that's what they say. Like, there was abuse going on, and his father beat the crap out of him.
It may not have been, like, cold blood.
Yeah.
Right.
It could have been self-defense, but we don't know yet.
We get the ring. You know, with the Dalton, we get the ring, and, you know, with these flashbacks, which translates, you know, with Stowe, Dalton, they have the same ring. You know, Hood does not have the ring, though. Just saying.
So you're saying that the ring is access to this secret club or branch.
And the tapping, the ring, exactly, yes. Mm.
I don't know necessarily if that's the same thing. I wonder if that's just a ring you get when you achieve a certain rank within the military.
Perhaps some sort of class ring situation.
It could also be a class ring situation.
In the same high school.
Or West Point.
I didn't pay for the
or
ring myself.
Something like that.
Yeah.
What's the one Frank Underwood went to? The Sentinel?
Oh, the Sentinel.
Yeah.
No.
But in any case, in this show, they never throw around anything willy-nilly, especially when it comes to piecing out and parsing out all of this copious backstory. And we got to see how Job and Hood met last episode because it's so it was important to highlight how far their relationship had fallen, what kind of toll it had taken, and how important Job was to the creation of the Hood that we know today.
Right.
Now that Job's been taken, and we now have this bit of information about Hood's background, you have to wonder, are these the same people who took Job? And I feel like he is in that room right now. Am I crazy about that?
No, I think there's a very strong chance. Whether it's that room or another room they have all over the country.
Yeah.
That are just like that for that purpose.
Well, I feel like we set up two key antagonists in this episode. Mm-hmm. We have this PSYOP secret part of the government, because obviously something was up with them. Otherwise, Hood would never have left. Mm-hmm. And the Aryan Brotherhood. And we'll get far more into them.
Yeah, that's really cool.
Yeah. Well, actually, let's just start talking about it now, because when Matt comes on the phone, we'll start talking to him about Kurt Bunker and their relationship. But yeah, so Hood really messed up when he made a snap judgment hiring this guy. Mm-hmm. That was my takeaway, was like, oh man, a lot of people's decisions this year are going to come back to bite them. In Kai's case, they already have.
Right.
But just deciding, you're hired. Holy crap.
Yeah, but he needed him.
Needed him in the moment. But at the same time, in that one decision has now brought a full-on war to Banshee.
And that's what Hood does. He brings full-on wars to Banshee.
But he's no longer the sheriff.
No, he's not.
He can't handle the war. He's not licensed.
Yeah, I know. I didn't think it was going to be a thing that stuck, but I'm actually really glad that it has. I really like the arc that they're creating with Bunker. I mean, Tom Pelfrey's doing an amazing job acting. That scene
incredible.
At the end where he's talking about, really he's back to pay for his sins, and also that he got his brother into the Aryan Brotherhood.
It's a big twist.
Yes, and that's likely the biggest reason that he's come back, when he comes back to give him talking about protecting his family, but then finding out that, like, he has no interest
he
in
He is
leaving.
In deep.
But I, as a Banshee as a whole, I actually like this storyline, because it makes Banshee just that much more eclectic, that much more filled with these colorful neighborhoods.
That's
communities.
Not the kind of word that they would like to be used about them.
I'm just saying, this Banshee, we already dealt. It's, you're right. It's almost antagonists, villains upon villains upon villains. Mm. I mean.
But
yeah.
we also have heroes, and one of them is now
man.
Sheriff Brock Lotus,
yes.
Mr. Matt Servitto. Are you with us, sir?
If you can hear me, yes, I am.
Yeah.
Hi, Matt.
Hey.
Welcome.
Hello, Matt.
We're in your beard right now.
We've all got Brock's beards to celebrate.
Mm-hmm. It takes me about an hour to grow that thing.
It looks that way.
Seriously, it's the thickest, fullest beard I've seen in quite some time.
Yeah. Also, what's your maintenance routine on this beard? Are we talking like an oil? Are we talking conditioner?
Yes.
I want to know.
Look, I'll tell you this. I mean, having kind of not used conditioner for about the last 20 years, it's nice to have a beard to use all the products again.
Okay.
The beard smells good, because usually it smells like what I've... That's why my daughters won't kiss me when I have the beard.
Okay.
It smells like what I just ate.
Oh, but Hoon said it smelled like strawberries, and Adam said it smelled like vanilla and jasmine, so I'm guessing it smells good.
Wow. It's kind of creepy that all the... That was all the guys on the show, you said, right?
Yes.
Yeah, well, they're the ones we've been interviewing, and they're all huge fans of your beard smell. So Matt, first of all, we're massive fans of your work on the show.
Absolutely.
And I nothing made me happier than in episode one of this season to get a glimpse into Brock's life. And I think that what they've been doing with your character this year is just sensational and very, very needed.
Absolutely.
How did you feel about your arc this season?
Well, I mean, it was, you know, first of all, it's just kind of, you know, the first couple seasons was, you know, it was similar to a lot of stuff that I had played in the past, whereas, you know, I'd had a lot of years playing law enforcement on various levels. But this show was so different. It was not a typical procedural. And, you know, I was sort of the moral center of the show. I mean, it would seem to be the only guy that knew the difference between right and wrong in a 75-mile radius. So I basically, you know, as much as I was enjoying that, and it was nice to be a foil to Hood, I finally talked to the writers. I'm like, I mean, I think everyone in this town has a past, you know, and I'd love to know if this guy's got some dark past. Even the goody-goodies have something that they're keeping down, and you know, I was encouraging them to sort of let's take this and see, let's run it out and see what we can find, and so you know, they immediately obviously were responding to that. And I also just felt like it's going to get old if I'm always or I'm going to be dead. I guess I was trying to save my life on the show, I think, is what I was really
good for you
to
for taking initiative,
seriously.
yeah I know I'm trying to make it out like it was some creative decision. I'm like, no, man, I need this job. let's figure out how can we extend Brock into a third season? Because truly, I could see the writing on the wall. It's like, actually, a little footnote. I don't think I don't think Jonathan Tropper would care if I said it at this point. I don't know if it came come up. Brock Lotus was supposed to be dead at the end of season one.
No.
What?
Yes. Yes. Wow. I can roll that out now. I hope.
It was your beard smell. Was that it? That kept you?
I had a one-year contract, and Brock was sort of a plot device to come in, and literally, like, in the last episode, the 10th episode of season one, after, you know, and so some of the stuff that started in season one, where you see Brock kind of, you know, not trusting him, and kind of seems to be the only one in the police force that's like, there's something about this guy, begins to dig and dig and dig until finally in episode 10, as they're going off to this siege, the shootout at the Metalworks with Rabbit and the bad guys.
Mm-hmm.
Basically Brock turns to Hood at some point in the shootout, or after he rescues him, or even before. Basically, I take a bullet, you know, and I'm like, I know who you are kind of thing, as I'm dying in Hood's arms. And, you know, so Hood doesn't kill me because he wants to keep his secret down. I actually get shot. But his secret is safe. But that was going to be the end of Brock and the end of the first season, and so his secret was safe till the beginning of season two.
So when
the only
did
one
you...
who knew that he was not Lucas Hood has just died.
So
and when... about halfway through season one, the writers, producers come to me and said, "We're just having too much fun with Brock, with you, with this character, and we don't want to get rid of you." I mean, so, you know, if you're interested in staying, we'd like to have you around. And I was, you know, feeling the same way. So I decided to stick around and sign an extended contract. And then they had to spend a lot of time in season two trying to figure out how to unkill me. Since basically, you know, the story had always been to kill me. It's like, okay, so now you're not dead. So now what? And like I said, that's when I felt like it was going to quickly get old if I was just always like, hey, you can't do that, Lucas Hood. And look, right, that's not how it's done in this town. And it's like, that's why this season, I know this is a long-winded answer to your question about this season, but
cool.
It comes full circle to, you know, going over to the dark side immediately right at the first 5 minutes of season three when we kill Hondo.
Yeah.
And it was very important to the writer and to myself that I sort of be the first one to pull the trigger on Hondo. I mean, you even see Hood look over at me and kind of like, your turn, buddy. This is your thing, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And from that point on, it was never the same for Brock. And, you know, it's as an actor, it's just a much more interesting ride.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, it feels like on many levels, one of the main themes of Banshee Season 3 is the corruption of Brock and, by extension, the entire sheriff's department. But of course, like, now that you finally have your dream job, you're finally the sheriff, it's a really interesting moment to say, wait a second, is Brock really any better for the job than anyone in the past, or better than Hood? Because he's just as corrupt.
Yeah. No, and I think you're tipping into season four immediately, because I think this is a be careful what you wish for kind of moment.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And truly, while Hood's been here, you know, it has quickly become the worst town in America. I mean, it was probably bad before, But I mean, he stirred the hornet's nest. It's a little bit like when he talks about, you know, that's why I love that moment in New Orleans where at the end after he dumped Chayton's body in the Mississippi River, and he says, "I'm not going back." And I'm like, "F you! You're not coming back. No way. I don't want to be like, you're coming back.
Yeah.
This is all on you, man. I'm not going to like take over now."
And that was an amazing scene as well. You're so earnest.
I love that moment. That actually, it's weird because I had friends start texting me at the end of that episode going, "Man, great season finale. I'm so excited for next season. That was great. What an ending, man." You know, yeah. And I'm like, "You know there's two more episodes, right?"
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
"No, I didn't know that, man." Hey, what are you talking about? Because it just felt like that was a perfect ending to the season.
It did. Yeah.
And we Hoon Lee and I were joking the other day because Jonathan Tropper, our writer, tweeted that he said, "Hey, welcome everybody to our third season finale." And Hoon and I kept saying, "The third season finale." I mean, it's the third time the show has tried to end this year.
Yeah.
Yes.
Episode 8 was one finale season. Episode 9 was another. And finally, 10 was the real true finale. But this is a show that every episode feels like a season finale, you know?
Yeah. Well, it's an embarrassment of riches, story-wise.
Yeah.
Now, I want to talk about Brock's relationship with Emily, which we got to see a lot of this season. And at some points, early on in the season, you feel like, okay, she's the one who's a little bit nuts, and Brock is wholly innocent in this divorce, that he was just too busy. But he's also just as intense.
Oh, yeah.
What draws these people together?
Have you ever noticed that, though? The most intense, nutty people seem to attract each other.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, it was truly like, I think, you know, we had to spend a lot of time kind of talking that out because it's, you know, and you see a bit of it in the, you know, the sex scene that we have in the first episode. And even that was toned down a bit from what was either on the page or what was discussed early on, because it really was kind of going to be much more kinky, kind of crazy, you know, a little more S&M.
Whoa.
And so you do see, so I mean, you really do see that these two have this kind of, you know, both a physical path that's very, you know, whether, you know, I don't know, not abusive, but just very interesting, and that kind of led into their personal lives. And I think, you know, the two of them truly, and that's what I like, you said, I like that it wasn't just sort of like, well, Emily's just crazy. It's like, and that's a little bit of what I was talking about, exploring Brock's past. And it's like, yeah, he was dedicated to the job, and that there truly was obviously some part of him, you know, whether it was just he had issues with intimacy, or, I mean, again, there was no kids. We talked about that. Do they have any kids? Their kid, right. You know, when they first talked about an ex-wife, I said, I'd love it if there's a kid. I'd love it if there's some, you know, financial problems. So, you know, if there is child support issues or something like that, Brock needs money. So does he get involved with Hood? Does he, you know, those sort of things. But no kids, was that maybe part of the problem, or were they never even interested in having children? You know, they're just neither one of them were the parenting kind. You know, so we discussed a lot of stuff, and I mean, a lot of it, you know, the history. It's hard as an actor because you cover a lot of ground. That all of that has to be shown in short bursts, a minute and a half here, 2 minutes here. You know, and you're really just hoping that a lot of the history that we've discussed and the depth comes through in a very short amount of time. You know,
absolutely.
Wait, so were you disappointed when they had to censor the sex scenes? Like, you know, it was really kinky. I want to get your overall first impression here.
Oh, you mean like when it actually got tamed down a little bit?
Yes.
You know, I mean, look, we were ready for anything, believe me. And Tanya Clark, who played Emily, is just great. And, you know, she was game for anything. And she just, you know, we truly sort of had to, it was my first, ironically, at this, you know, point in my career to finally get like my first full-on sex scene. I've done sex scenes for comic effect, truly, because I'm a walking sight gag naked. But
come on,
you know,
hashtag Brock's buff. Hashtag Brock's buff.
Believe me.
Yeah.
I kept waiting for like woman has sex with primate on Cinemax and no one cares. Like no one.
Listen, that's happened before on this network, but now it's a new day.
Know,
we
like
have original programming now.
Video. But it was, I so, you know, Tanya and I really kind of had talked about some stuff that kind of, you know, talked about the physicality of it. And we shot some of it. They did tone it down. It just took the Lotuses to a place so quickly, and it was the first episode, and I thought, yeah, there's almost like no recovering from this. You're like, what the hell did I just see, and who are these people? But story-wise, it had to get, you know, to another place, because clearly it was heading, she was heading towards Proctor,
right,
and heading towards, yeah, that storyline. So, you know, it's not like we were going to see this ongoing sick, twisted physical relationship between these two. I don't even mean to put labels on it. Not even sick, just a truly different type of, you know, physical needs, I'll say. Yeah. And, but yeah, I mean, we, you know, like I said, we went there as actors. We were pretty open about it. We tried some stuff, you know, some stuff made them kind of go, don't do that. Yeah, let's not do that one again. Let's try something else on this take, you know.
Are we going to see Emily in season 4?
I have no idea. I mean, you clearly, you know, there was clearly a bit of a button, obviously, with her and Proctor, as you saw in episode 9.
Sure.
I don't know. I mean, I really don't know. That actually, what little I know of season 4, that never came up. You know, it's just, I imagine it would be great to have her back, because, like I said, I just really enjoy working with Tanya, and she's a brave actress and not afraid of just anything they want to throw story-wise, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah. Do you have questions?
I have some fan questions for you, Matt.
Sure.
Who, Saif asks, who is the funniest member of the cast?
Oh, interesting. Who's the funniest member?
It's probably you. If you don't know, it's probably you.
No, it's not just one. I would say it's between Antony and Ulrich.
Mm-hmm.
Ulrich, Ulrich is so dry. Invariably, I mean, Antony and I laugh the most at Ulrich. His delivery is so Danish and so dry and so cutting. So we, you know, we find ourselves. Antony is outrageous, and that's why I love that he's, you know, Hood. I try to post pictures on Twitter of Antony laughing, because he's a goofball, and he loves to laugh. And we spend a lot of time, you know, just enjoying ourselves on set. So, but he's so good at playing heavy and serious. So whenever I'm able to post a picture of Antony, I'm just like between takes laughing. The fans are like, oh my God, I've never seen him smile. Like, that's amazing. Look at him like belly laughing, you know. But he's a goofball. And I've said to him, I said, when this is all over, you and I are going to go find like the silliest bromance comedy script we can find.
Great.
Let the real Antony Starr out.
Yeah.
We'll watch
that. Can you tell us about a time where Ant or Ulrich really made you laugh?
Oh, let me think of a specific moment. there was a chase sequence, you know, where I had to have surgery on my foot. Matt, me in real life, had to have surgery on my foot. And we had a chase sequence. It's got to be first season, maybe early second season. We're chasing down this kid. And I think he was probably a skinhead. And I just couldn't keep up. And he just kept making comments, take after take after take. And actually, then he started just kind of making them in character, none of which they used, because they were hysterical. But it was like, I just had not fully recovered from the surgery yet. And so I was limping, take after take. And finally, I just started busting a gut on every take. And I said, can't I just literally pull out my gun and shoot the kid? Like, I guess Brock is winded. You know, I always wanted Brock to be like that Indiana Jones moment with like the guy with the sword, and Indiana Jones looks at him and goes, oh, like, just shoots him, you know. Yeah. I want, every time they write a fight sequence, I'm like, yeah, I think I should just probably put my gun out here.
You know, hey, Brock, that sounds like season 4 Brock to me.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Oh, believe me. I was just looking at the finale again today, and there's this great sequence where they cut between all the badass people on the show in slow motion. You've got T. Proctor with Burton and Rebecca, and they're walking in slow motion, mm-hmm, and like fire behind them, and they're shooting. And then you got, you know, the team busting out of the General Stowe's lair, mm-hmm, and they're all firing. It's all in slow motion. And the next thing you see is Brock eating at the diner. And I wish it was in slow motion. I'm like, that should have been awesome. Like, just slow motion, like powdered sugar coming off my beard.
Yeah.
You know,
10,000 frames a second, like with the phantom cameras. It just bounces, crumbs bouncing away from your mouth.
Yeah, it was just like I thought the timing of that. It's like cool, and then Brock at Miles Diner eating, you know, close on my mouth. I was like, oh my god. And then like, and then they cut to Bunker just sitting across from me, staring at me. I love that stuff, man. I love it. If there's one thing I hope we continue to, you know, even for Brock as well. I mean, I love doing a lot of the, you know, the dry Brock humor stuff. And Jonathan Tropper, who just, you know, Jonathan's such a great writer and a great novelist, and his novels are actually much more funny than Banshee ever will be. And I love when he lets a little bit of that Tropper humor come through, and that's usually in you know, the lines that he gives me, just like smart-ass one-liners. And I know I have to, I think Adam Targum said I had to mention his name 20 times.
Okay, good.
It's
okay.
Just the beginning. Yep. So there's number one, Adam Targum. Adam loves all those kind of buddy 80s, you know, Die Hard, Lethal Weapon movies, and he just loves writing these great zingers, you know, a lot of the stuff that the fans have tweeted about. Usually those are Adam's lines on the buttons on seats. It's just a blast.
We have a question actually from a fan. Stacy is asking, or somebody asked, but do you ever, Stacy, she says, I love your one-liners. Are they all written? Have you ever ad-libbed one?
I have, but you know what? His are better than my ad-libs. It's funny, I do a lot of comedy. You know, my other stuff, I do a lot of comedy, but it's so specific to Brock, and it's Adam just truly has such a good sense of the character, and the timing is always perfect, and it's usually just a layup, and I'm like, if I start, and I've done a little bit of the riffing, and I'm like, you know what, let's just go back to the script. It was better the way it was.
Yeah. And one more question, this one's pretty cute, from Brian. Will Platinum ever tell Brock her real name?
They have such a good relationship.
That was good.
Kate's great. I doubt it, and it's funny because I don't know if the joke ever really, the double M on Platinum.
We got it.
Yeah, and I mean, because we did a whole series when we did that scene in the strip club this season. I think a little bit of it made it in, but I kept saying the name over and over again with the double M. So I go, Platinum, what do you think I should do? She'd say something, and I know Platinum. But it just went, and they were like, it's too much. And I was like enjoying myself. We were getting, you know, laughing our heads off. But it was just, you know, I just wanted to make sure they all knew this was her double M name that she had come up with. She actually, her and I, when we did a scene in season one, that was a lot of that was improv. And that unfortunately had to be cut down to nothing. But they just let the cameras roll for 10 minutes. She's amazing. And she just did this whole improv as Platinum, and I was just trying to keep up with her because she was hysterical.
Fantastic. Wow. Awesome. One last question, and then we got to move on. There's a very key scene in this episode towards the end where you and Kurt Bunker really get a chance to bond, and you talk him down from his, you know, lonely in the dark rage gripping. And it's really vitally important because now that Hood is vacating the captain's chair, so to speak, we have to have a reason for Bunker to be as loyal to Brock as he is to Hood. I guess I wanted to ask what you see in Bunker.
Where do I see Bunker going,
does Brock see in Bunker? Like, does he see a kindred spirit in that he's kind of... Go ahead.
I was thinking about, you know, the other day when I was rewatching the episode. I mean, there's just, I think there's a loyalty there. I mean, that, what you realize is what this guy has always been is loyal. And it's like, if you can harness that loyalty, which he had to the Brotherhood, and now he's given to the BSD, and if it could be harnessed for good, he's so passionate about things that he's loyal about, that he's almost truly like a, you know, a service dog, like so dedicated and singular focused. And I, you know, that's what I keep wondering, if this guy's going to become for Brock that kind of, like, you know, raging dog I've got just on a leash, but when I need him, I let him go and he absolutely tears it up, but I've got to kind of keep him back. But when I need this guy, he's just my pit bull, you know? But I think he's just, I think there's also, you know, he's young. I mean, Tom, there's an age difference between Tom and I as well. Mm-hmm. A lot of that, you know, struggle of youth, I think I see a lot of that too. I mean, which is something I probably am in denial about how much older I am, but I'm like, I just think that there is a thought, you know, you can tell this guy just has never quite had and well, I think he discusses a bit about his father, and his father, you know, kind of brought him into that whole world, and I think he's probably looking for somebody to pull him out of it.
Yeah.
Do you think there's like a moment when, because I remember early on, like you're like, really, this guy Hood? You know, Brock says that to him, and then now it seems like he has some empathy for him and gives that great talk to him. Do you think there's a moment when Brock decided that this guy needs someone?
This guy what?
Did Bunker need someone to give him this advice when you see him kind of destroy himself?
Yeah, I mean, you know, the thing with Banshee is, you know, it's very short form storytelling. I mean, there's so much that happens off camera, because what we focus on generally in the story, we push all of the big moments to the forefront. And that's why I love that scene with Tom and I in episode 10. It was, I mean, that was truly one of the longest talking scenes I think we've ever run out. Probably other than Tom and Afton, in the siege in the episode 5 when we were all stuck inside the caddy. He had that scene where he first describes how he ended up there, who he is, and it was incredible. But that scene got, you know, normally scenes like that get cut down. They didn't cut it. They didn't cut a word.
Wow. Yeah,
they left every frame, every word, and you know, it was just such a joy to actually let a real breathing, you know, scene between two characters, because that's usually backstory. That's usually history you don't get on Banshee. You just have to assume moments like that have happened because we just keep cut to the action. And then we finally earn a moment of reflection at the bar at the Forge,
right,
or a moment in the diner to catch your breath. And so Tom's had a good, you know, it's very important to the writers. Adam Targum and Jonathan Tropper, I think I've said Adam's name maybe three now. It was very important to them, I think, that the audience knows who this guy is going into season 4.
Right. All right.
Sorry,
Matt. I apologize. Just we're running low on time, so we need to jump back into plot. But if you'd like, please stick around and tell us more your thoughts on the finale and anything else you want to talk about.
Sure.
So let's talk briefly. Poor Gordon. Rest in peace. Called it last week.
We did.
You did.
Yeah.
You did. Good job, guys.
And I was worried about other folks, and people were tweeting me long before I got to see the episode, which is fun. But I thought that this sequence was really expertly staged. When Gordon pops out of that truck with an assault rifle and grenade launcher and is just so brutally effective, he kills like 4 guys in a row.
It was hot.
Before anything else happens.
It was like he was made to do this. It was like, rather than being Mir, he was made for this.
He was built for war.
Well, he wasn't the only gunslinger in the family. He said so.
Yeah.
That's true. I also like him making the decision to put his beef or whatever with Hood aside to go save his woman.
Mm. Yeah, it shows his growth as well.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Not only that he's willing to trust Hood, but that he's also willing to cross some lines and take lives if necessary for what he believes in.
Because he truly loves her. He says that at the end.
Yeah.
And I really like, you know, in this episode, instead of, say, you know, a sex montage, the main montage was Gordon and Hood putting their guns together. Make what you want of that.
That's some form of sex montage. Someone considers that very sexy. I was really pleased that we didn't, pleased and disappointed at the same time, that we didn't get a Stowe versus Hood fight, and that it was a Stowe and Anna fight. Because honestly, if you really look at the construction of the season, it really is Anna's fight and Anna's kill.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say.
To get, really.
It's much more powerful and meaningful for her to be the one to best him. Also, I really think that's amazing writing to not have her be saved by a man. She can save herself. I thought that was cool.
Yeah, absolutely. I want to know who would win between the two of them, but I think it's far more important instead to have her fight him, and also to have Hood be faced with the same moment as when he lost Siobhan 5 episodes ago.
Yeah, and decide this time to spring into action. He's not going to let it happen again.
Yeah.
Thank
really
God.
Cool. Yeah. So, farewell, Gordon. Mm-hmm. Everyone's very sad, and I am too, because you had finally become a character that I was really caring about, but that's the best time to kill someone off. Unless, of course, you like him so much that you write him on for the rest of the series, like Brock.
Yes.
Yeah. So, I want to talk about Kai and Rebecca and Burton and their buddy Morales. whom they gifted a really kick-ass sword.
Oh yeah, it was like a Kill Bill type sword. Oop. Yeah.
Well, it was a Chinese sword, not a Japanese sword.
Yeah, true. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. But but still, this guy Morales, he's a little crazy.
You think?
Frazier is ruthless and brutal, but he's also a businessman. He's smart. Morales is a nutcase.
Yeah, but you see a lot of characters teaming up in this episode with characters that they have odds with to accomplish a goal that are allies. And because of Hector having that like mark on the back of his head that was given to him
by Frazier.
By Frazier, you can trust Kai can trust him in this situation. And
in this situation, but he's about to put him in power in Philadelphia.
Yeah, I wonder if maybe Frazier's words to him, like he's gonna screw you over too. It's probably some sort of foreshadowing.
Maybe.
I'm sure.
Yeah. Also, Rebecca, go into battle with more than 6 bullets.
And the proper shoes.
And yes, the proper shoes.
The proper shoes. Yeah.
She's a great shot, and she's running around
apparently.
In those heels.
Apparently, she's just a great shot out of nowhere. She's got no purse. She has nowhere else to keep spare bullets. It's a revolver. It doesn't work like that.
It's true.
True. But glad that this storyline with Kai is over, because I think the far more compelling storyline that is introduced at the very end of the episode is now that Sheriff Hood is no longer the sheriff and he's just a man, Kai, it closes on that smile of his, that chilling smile. I'm so pleased.
Yeah, it was awesome.
Because here's the thing. Not only is he down one nemesis, at least in terms of like law, good and evil, whatever, but now he's just a man. If he kills Sheriff Hood, not a ton, like it's not going to be as bad as if he killed an actual law enforcement member. Also, I feel like on some level he might try to bring him back into the fold.
I totally picked that up.
Yeah,
that
yeah.
He's got this smile because he's a businessman, he's enterprising, he's thinking exactly what Dalton thought, which was, I could really use this guy. I need a pit bull. We'll see how that develops.
Now, have we seen Kai smile as much as he did in this particular moment? I've never seen Kai truly, emphatically, Mowgli-esque smile.
Yeah, I mean, he smiled a bit when he was with Emily, but it was a different kind of oh, good, smile.
Yes.
But
Matt, do you want to pitch in?
Hello?
Oh, maybe he's not there anymore.
I don't know.
Hello?
It's okay. Make your point, Mana.
Oh, but anyway, yes. But speaking of Matt, now, that Brock, is the new sheriff. He now has kind of two enemies to go after. I mean, two people that he's always, he's always kind of been jealous of Hood, and he doesn't like how Hood is always taking everything in his own hands, and he's always wanted to go after Kai. I mean, so in a way, if Hood and Kai are now one, that's a big dilemma.
I don't know that they're going to be one, but I think that they're learning to coexist. Mm-hmm. Now, if I take off my podcaster hat and then put on my showrunner helmet, which is very roomy.
Mm. Whoa.
Yeah, I know, it's big. We're at the end of season 3. We have 2 projected seasons left in the show, 8 episodes each. At some point, Kai has to get his comeuppance. So if Hood is no longer sheriff, they're going to find a reason to collide by the end of season 4. He has to have a reason to kick Kai's ass in season 5. And I'm very, very curious about what that is. I wonder if the Aryan Brotherhood is going to play into it. I wonder if the PsyOps folks are going to play into it. Who knows? Anyone have a theory on hand?
I don't, but I do think the whatever Black Ops was involved, I really think that's going to be in the storyline in season 4.
Right on. Okay, any final thoughts before we move into predictions? I would just want to say I'm glad we finally got to see Sugar throw a punch.
Yes.
Yeah, that knockout punch was sweet, man. Only took one.
Only one.
We saw Job and Anna look at like, wow, that's who we've been with this whole time? Okay.
Uh-huh.
I do have a shout out I would like to give.
Sure.
To Robert Kern III. He is the designer and maker of these wonderful Brock's beards.
Hell yeah, go Robert. These are awesome.
Matt, are you still there?
I lost you, but I came back.
Thank you so much. So Robert Kern III is an artist living in Baltimore, Maryland, and he draws, paints, designs websites, etc. He's a huge fan of Mr. Servitto because of a show called Brotherhood. When I saw his new look in the first episode of Banshee this season, I took it upon myself to get Brock's beard, hashtag Brock's beard, trending. He made this beard, and I want everyone to follow him on Twitter. Yeah. He is at rkern3, and you can get your very own Brock's beard from him. If he could ask Servitto anything, it would be what he thinks of the whole hashtag Brock's beard phenomenon.
Yeah.
It's also, somebody just got the account. I saw that too. Just started following. I don't know if it's him as well, because I just started following Brock's beard on Twitter today, I think.
Yeah, actually, you won a t-shirt for one of our fans, because another fan, Britt, offered a t-shirt if we could get you to follow Brock's beard. And you did. And so Jumbo Shrimp's getting a t-shirt.
Oh, no, I love it. I mean, and the cutout beard are just amazing. I'm going to give a shout out to Greg Utain, it's our producer, because the beard was his idea.
Oh.
It was a plot device. Basically, he called me last February. He said, "How quickly can you grow a beard?" And I said, "In about an hour." I said, "Well, what's up?" He said, "Because I need to suggest to the audience, right immediately at the opening of season 3, that time has passed." Because the time between seasons 1 and season 2 was about a week. We basically had the shootout at the Metalworks with Rabbit and the guys, and it's about a week later, and you've got the feds there, and we're all on trial. Very little time has passed. Between seasons 2 and 3, there's a suggestion that a few months have passed.
Yeah.
Emmett has died. Emmett's been buried. Mm-hmm. Hondo did not get convicted for his murder, and he's gotten off, and we know where he is. So he said, "I immediately want the, as soon as the audience sees you with a beard, they're going to know that time has passed. This was not like a week. This was not even a couple of weeks. Like, you've grown a beard. Things have changed. It's a little bit different." I said, "Cool. I love it." So it was really only, and again, it was only going to be for the first episode.
Oh.
And then all of a sudden everybody saw the beard and they're like, "Oh, we're keeping that beard."
Yeah.
In fact, they may fire me and keep the beard. That's what I'm afraid of. I would love it if just my beard kept making appearances.
Yeah, that would be great.
Well, it can now with our handy-dandy cutouts.
I know.
There was a fan that I don't remember on Twitter that wanted to ask you, Matt, what's one of your favorite scenes that you've gotten to play as Brock?
You know what, man? It was probably the scene at Emmett's tomb.
That's the one they mentioned, too, yeah.
Yeah, I was very close to Demetrius, who played Emmett, and... I basically just that was a little bit of real whiskey in that glass, and it was a real real cold night, and they put that was a our art department made that tomb, and as soon as I walked up there, I'm like, "Let's just start rolling the cameras, because I'm about to lose it right now."
Oh.
And it just was truly, I was talking to him, and I'd given him a call like the day before just to hear his voice. Check in with him in LA. He's doing great, by the way. But it was just, I wanted to use all that as an actor. But that, you don't get moments like that too often on television, where you truly just, with your thoughts, expressing something. And it was wonderful. I just loved doing that.
Yeah, fantastic. It was beautiful, and your performance was stellar. I was way into it.
No, thanks.
Well, unfortunately, we are running low on time, so it is time now.
By the way, I loved all your predictions for 4. I will tell you.
Okay.
Yes, yes, no, no, yes. From what I heard.
How am I going to remember the order of what I said, Matt?
Yeah, I'm just saying. Even though my phone call had it stopped and I couldn't hear you, I'm just guessing. I'll tell you this. There is no way anyone is going to guess. You can make all the predictions you want, because this blew my mind when I began to get an inkling of what season 4 is.
Okay.
I don't know if no one will predict what season 4 is, because it is the writers just went off the hook. I couldn't believe when they came to me with the suggestion. I'm like, not a suggestion, I mean what they were going to do, and I just thought, that's insane. I love it.
Game on, Servitto. We're going to predict away right here, right now. It's time.
It. Please do, because I'm telling you, if somebody picks up on this, it'll be amazing. I would love to hear your thoughts on this.
Wait. So you're saying there's something to pick up on. Is it something that we could possibly get from what we've seen so far?
I mean, look, it's who's left, mm-hmm. you know who's still on the show, you know who's gone. Those elements are pretty solid, but it is just God, how can I? I know I have to be careful. I have to mince my words here because Adam Targum.
Yep.
Yeah. Told me, you know, he told me to mention his name but not say anything. It's construction. It's pretty amazing. I mean, what they're talking about doing, because I have to say the show up to this point has been so aerobic. It's been so fast and furious, and I didn't think we could top season two, and we did. Mm-hmm. I don't think we can top season three. I mean, in regards to the pace of the show, not acting wise, not stories. I know we can keep going and do better, but I mean, the pace has just finally, I think, outrun us. And I keep saying, I'm wondering if we have to slow down, make it more mysterious, make it darker, go deeper, right. You know. And I'm not saying that that's where it's going. Me as an actor, I was kind of thinking, maybe that's where we should start looking in that direction. But knowing Adam and Jonathan, they won't do that.
Yeah.
They probably won't do that at all.
Well, Matt, I want to thank you so much for joining us. We're unfortunately out of time, so we just have time for predictions. But where can people find you online?
Say that again?
Where can people find you online on Twitter?
I'm on at Matt Servitto on Twitter, and I'm on Facebook. And what I do with Twitter is I just put up a ton of pictures. I am the backstage photographer. So if you want to watch us as we're shooting season four and you're like having your Banshee, withdrawal, just truly check in on my Twitter account, because I'll be posting stuff all summer long of behind the scenes stuff.
Awesome.
Thank you so much, Matt.
Thanks, Matt.
It's been a real pleasure.
You bet, man. My pleasure. Thanks for having me on, guys.
Absolutely. Anytime.
Bye.
All right. Take care. Good night now.
All right. Now, it is time for predictions.
And now, your AfterBuzz TV predictions.
Matt Servitto says there's no way that we could possibly predict what's happening in season four. I humbly disagree.
Okay. Doesn't sound so humble. It sounds.
Oh
proud.
No! I am extremely humble right now in this moment,
like a proud
right
moment
here.
To me. I'm not really sure.
I'm gonna throw this out there to the room, to the moon, and back. Okay. When we pick up in season four, bold statement: Brock Lotus, in control of the Banshee Sheriff's Department, has just declared all-out, unending war on Kai Proctor. It is just the most corrupt thorn in his side, not giving a crap about paperwork. He's seen how effective Sheriff Hood's style of policing is, and he's not going back. He's not going back one bit. However, he doesn't have any of the training or strength to back it up. So instead, he's got his guard dog on one side, Kurt Bunker. And on the other side, he's got Billy Raven. Poor Billy Raven, who couldn't even get out of bed for this 10th episode. He was trying to say, oh, boss, we can't be doing that. Not now. Bunker, get him. Yeah. That's where I'm seeing us pick up in season four. I'll leave my other stuff to the end. Manas?
Well, first of all, really quick, I know what Oriana and Isaac are ordering at Miles Diner. What are you going to be ordering at Miles Diner, Matt?
I'm going to ignore your strenuous objections, and I'm going to get the hamburger.
It is made with filet mignon, ground
That's
up.
That's just
so
a waste of filet. You don't need. You just need
so
a fatty. No, you need a fatty cut for
right,
a burger.
80-20. All right,
at
all
least.
Right. Well, okay, in terms of predictions, you know, every season deals, though, the big thing I feel is always a bank heist. Well, I feel the heist here, it's not really going to be money. It's going to be Job. That's going to be first and foremost. I mean, that is now the heist. What's the treasure? There really isn't going to be, let's get some money, you know. It's going to be, we need to get Job. That's what's going to bring the band back together.
All right. I actually agree with what both of you are saying. Mm-hmm. I think we will see Hood and Anna / Carrie rekindle in some way, because they've both lost and now they're alone and they love each other and they just belong together, okay?
Unless she blames him for bringing Gordon
and
along.
And she may. I think Bunker's going to be recovering, and that is going to essentially fuel his anger that he is going to have to heal all these burns off his body. Mm-hmm. And otherwise, I kind of like it. I think Brock's going to... He's going to want to be Hood, but he can't. And Job, I think, we're going to learn a lot more about Job. We're going to learn a lot more about this branch of military that no one knows about, that they have been involved in. So I think Dalton's going to come back to haunt them.
Great. Isaac?
Yeah, well, I don't see them introducing Dalton without it, you know, finishing, you know, that storyline. So I think we're going to see Dalton next season. I don't know how corrupt Brock's going to be. I don't feel like you can make him that corrupt.
I think you can.
Oh, no, he's just a voice of reason to me. And yes, he has done bad things, which is probably why you can relate to Bunker, which is really cool. I'm very interested to see the Bunker storyline. Mm-hmm. Tom Pelfrey's an amazing actor. Everybody's an amazing actor on the show. But I think what they're doing with that, the idea of redemption, is really compelling. I'm very much interested in seeing it. And I think we're going to get Joe back in like 3 episodes.
I'd like that.
I would, yeah, too.
I don't think it's going to be like a season-long thing, although I'd love to see where they're going, but I think that's just to introduce Dalton.
I feel like...
get him back.
Yeah. I feel like getting Joe back is more of our Siobhan getting killed mid-season kind of episode. So yeah. I'd look for that in episode 4.
Four or five, I would say.
Three.
All right. Three, four, five.
And really quick, to make a point,
what episode do you think they're going to get Job back?
Two.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Yeah, they're going to... Because we're only dealing with 8 episodes, remember.
Gotta go fast.
I know. Exactly. Also, predictions-wise, technically, I feel, you know, the directors and the filmmakers, without the story, really changed the game up this season. Technically-wise, we saw in the directing standpoint, I feel we're still going to get a shift. I feel we're going to see, like, an episode where everything's done in, like, a one-shot, or they're really going to play with, like, the camera tricks and the distortions a lot. I mean, the look we're even going to see is going to evolve even more, I'm just saying.
Okay. Yeah, that's certainly going to happen. I mean, this show is, like, to me, and I'll say these are my feelings about it, but I've had a hole in my heart, I'll just say, in the shape of a Walter White for quite some time. And this show, after now watching 3 seasons of it, has filled that hole in the shape of a sheriff's badge.
Phrasing.
I'll cheers to that.
I really
cheers.
Love the show.
Cheers. Cheers, baby. Cheers.
Hell yeah. One last thought. I think if Brock is not supremely corrupt when we meet him, by the end of the season, he will have to go and partner with Kai Proctor. The one thing he always said that he never wanted to do, to take on the Aryan Brotherhood.
Oh, good one.
No, that's Bunker's fight alone, man.
It's not, because Brock is loyal to him.
He's loyal, but I think that's Bunker's issue to resolve.
He gives him food and treats. No. And he takes care of his Aryan brothers.
Yeah, no, don't see it happening.
Fair enough. Folks, I want to thank you so much for joining us all season long. It is our dearest intent to come back with a season 1 recap before the end of the year. Mm-hmm. So keep your eyes peeled to our Twitters, and we will let you know when that's happening.
Well, so I did tweet today that we would say if we were doing that or not.
And we're doing it.
We're doing it.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
It's just a question of when. It might be in a few months when things calm down here at AfterBuzz, but we will let you know. Certainly, as soon as we know, that's when you will know. You should visit iTunes, rate and review the show. It just helps everyone out here, and it helps us get sponsors and guests like Matt Servitto. So please go and do. Modest, where can the people find you?
Find me on Twitter at RestFiction. That stands for RestaurantFiction.com. Also on iTunes, just look up Restaurant Fiction.
Okay, Oriana.
You can find me at Miss Oriana Leo on Twitter or Oriana Leo on Instagram. Thank you so much for all the love and support, you Fanshee babes, this season. This is my favorite show, and I love sharing it with you guys. As Matt said, stay tuned to my Twitter account. I may be doing some behind-the-scenes season 4 stuff this summer for Banshee. Mm-hmm. So keep your eyes peeled to my Twitter account, and you'll be the first to know.
Fantastic. And Isaac?
You can follow me on Twitter at Isaac Johnson, Instagram The Isaac Johnson, and YouTube also The Isaac Johnson. Check out my music video. And thank you as well to all the fancy babes who've welcomed me with open arms and tweeted with me today. It made me feel special. Thank
Yay!
You.
Yeah.
And folks, you can find me on Twitter at Matt Lieberman. That's MattLieberman. You can find me here doing Better Call Saul. My personal channel, youtube.com/C/Matt Lieberman, and SourceFed Nerd. Thank you all so much. See you next season. Goodbye.
From executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Banshees rule!
Views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.